Yes, sir.
Raise your right hand. Solemnly swear the evidence you're about to give in the matter now pending before this board will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God.
Yes, sir.
You state your name for the record.
Shawn Corrigan.
You can lower your hand. And your position with Forsyth County Fire Department.
Firefighter EMT, Destination 4.
Thank you. You may examine, Mr. Mondello.
Thank you. Good morning, Mr. Corrigan.
Good morning.
How long have you been a firefighter for Forsyth County?
About a year and a half.
Okay. And at approximately April of last year, what was your status of employment with the county?
Probationary firefighter.
Probationary firefighter?
Yeah.
And what exactly does that mean to be a probationary firefighter?
It means the county has a set rule for a whole year from start to a whole year. You're on probation for, they put you on a probationary period where if something would happen, or it's easier for them to let you go. So, you know, they gotta make sure you know your job within that time frame, that year, and stuff like that, so then they can sign you off to be a full-fledged firefighter. This means someone's watching you at all times.
And at approximately April of last year, how long have you been in that probationary status?
That was about 9 months, something like 9 months.
9 months?
Yeah.
Do you recall the events of April 3rd, 2011?
Yes, I do.
Okay. What do you recall about that day? Where were you working that day?
Station 4.
Okay. And who was your supervisor at that time?
Lieutenant Cranford.
And what was your opinion of Lieutenant Cranford at that time?
I mean, we, as far as working as a team, we got along well. I had no problems whatsoever with working with him or at that station.
Okay. And on April 3rd, did you speak with Lieutenant Cranford regarding a workers' comp injury?
I did.
Okay. What happened at that time? What do you recall?
As far as when that first came about, I was working out in the Bay Area, about somewhere around 4:30, somewhere around that time frame. I came into the building, and Lieutenant Cranford and Firefighter Kennedy were both talking at the island in the kitchen. And they were on one side, Lieutenant Cranford was over here, Firefighter Kennedy was over here. And I can assume they were talking about a workman's comp claim because he presented it to me, but I was in the middle of my workout. So I ended up, he asked me to read it. I was like, well, as soon as I get done my workout, got some water, went back and worked out, came back in, read the incident statement, and.
I'm gonna interrupt you for a second. I would like you to look at that document there, which is marked Forsyth County 1. If you could turn to the third page for me, that document. Is that third page the document that Lieutenant Cranford presented to you?
Yes, it is.
And is that the document you say you read on April 3rd?
Yes.
And when you read that document, what was your reaction to it?
I was pretty upset.
Why is that?
Because it never happened.
When you say it never happened, please, if you could specifically explain why it never happened.
We never did ladder training that day at Station 4.
Had you ever done ladder training at Station 4?
Not up to that point, not at Station 4.
Okay.
With Lieutenant Cranford.
Prior to this incident, had you ever seen Lieutenant Cranford fall from the ladder during a training exercise?
No, I haven't.
You had not?
No.
Prior to that incident, prior to April 3rd, had you seen anyone in your group fall from a ladder during a training exercise?
Firefighter currently fell from the ladder. I don't know if it was prior to that or after that at headquarters.
Okay. So when you read that report and you say you were upset about it, what did you do?
Absolutely nothing. I was pretty upset. Read it. He asked me if I had any questions on it. I said no. And I went outside and played basketball for 2 hours because I was upset and didn't know what to do.
Did you feel that you could talk to anybody about the situation?
Not at the present time.
And why was that?
First being I was on probationary period, and I felt like that would be more eyes on me, and I didn't know how that would betray me, and just in general. Second, he's my lieutenant, so he's my boss, and it's hard, you know, I don't like to step over anybody's toes. And third, I felt like it really was my job to to look after him. You know, it's not my responsibility, so.
Subsequently, did you talk to anyone about this incident?
That evening, and did not. I think the following shift, I talked with Firefighter Kennedy, and the conversation went something like, you know, we felt, how could we be put in this situation? We felt like, you know, it was just wrong to happen, and we were a little upset, for sure.
And after that, when was the next time you dealt with these issues?
After that, nothing was said until I came back from the hospital therapy sometime in the afternoon when Lieutenant Lindstrom and Chief Chapman was there, and they told me that they sent Jeremy home, paid leave, and that they would interview me the next shift, and I didn't even know what it was for until I was interviewed.
Between when you first found out about this claim on April 3rd and when Lieutenant Lindstrom went to interview you, how did you feel about the whole situation?
Not good. Definitely not good. It's something, you know, that was always in the back of my mind, you know, and I didn't know what to do about it, so I didn't do anything.
In your mind, did this situation impact your ability to interact and work with Lieutenant Cranford during those months?
No, we still got along and did what we need to do our job.
But it was just in the back of your mind?
Yeah.
One second. I'm going to take a look. You should be another document, a photograph.
No, but I put it back.
That hasn't been sent.
Pardon me. Thank you. I'm going to show you this screenshot. This is Marcus Forsyth County 2. Do you recognize what that is?
Yeah, it's a training log. When we do training, we have to input it into the computer to get credit for it.
And what is the date indicated for that training log?
4/3/2011.
And what kind of training is described for that training log?
Ladders.
Does it indicate that you engaged in training?
It does.
And what station does it say this training took place at?
4.
Did you in fact enter this data onto the computer, onto the training log?
No, at this time I didn't even know how to enter anything into the computer, so I would not have.
Did you fill out any paperwork related to any training that may have taken place on April 3rd?
No, I didn't.
In fact, did any training take place on April 3rd, 2011?
No, it did not.
I have nothing further at this time, subject to cross-examination, and I can take the photograph back.
Cross-examination, Mr. Jones?
Yes, thank you, please. Had you had any issues with Lieutenant Cranford before the date that you that he presented this workers' compensation form to you?
No, I did not.
Say that you respected and admired him.
Yes.
And I think that you stated earlier that two of you had a very good relationship up to that point.
Correct.
So why exactly did you feel so inhibited about saying this is what happened?
Like I stated earlier, first off, I was on probation up there. The second of all, he's my boss, and I generally respect my bosses, and I try to follow them.
Would you have considered Lieutenant Cranford to have been a stickler for our rules? And I don't know if you are aware of the incident involving Mr. Kennerly's headset, for example.
I was aware that I was there for that. Okay.
Were you aware of the back and forth between the two of them about whether or not headsets were allowed?
I know there was stuff going on between the two.
Okay. And would you say that Lieutenant Cranford did make the effort to look into it to find out what was allowed and what wasn't?
Correct. I believe you did everything that you should in that situation.
Was that usually your experience when you come up to that point?
Yes, it was.
Okay, so wouldn't you have considered this incident to have been highly unusual?
Correct. And that's why I was so upset about the whole situation.
Would you have considered yourself distraught?
Not distraught, just upset that I was involved, had to be involved in that.
Would you speak with anyone else about the incident that day?
My wife.
Okay, and how soon after, and by incident, I guess I mean this conversation where the three of you were present in the kitchen?
I'm sorry, sir.
The three of you were there in the kitchen, right? Or the counter?
Correct.
Was it a kitchen counter?
Yeah, at like an island.
Okay. So the three of you were in there. How long after that was it before you spoke with your wife about the incident?
Well, as I stated earlier, I walked into the conversation of them two talking about the incident, and then I left, and then I came back in and read the statement. And then after I read the statement, I went back outside and played some basketball, so it was probably about 45 minutes after, somewhere around there.
Okay, well, earlier you stated that you had to do your workout first.
Correct.
How long did your workout take?
Generally, it takes about an hour, hour and a half.
Okay, if you left to go do your workout, and that took an hour to an hour and a half, and then after that you came back in?
About three-fourths of the way through it, I came back. Yeah.
Three-fourths of the way through your workout?
Correct.
I'm sorry, can you take me through what happened?
I can't remember exactly what time I started working out at, but I know I came in between 4 and 4:30, so I probably started working out about 3:15, 3:25, somewhere around there, to get some water, and they were talking about the incident. And I was only in there for a couple minutes, and then left, finished my workouts, and came back in, and read the statement.
And then after that, you left to go play basketball?
Well, I went to the driveway, played basketball, yes.
And you were playing basketball for how long?
It was probably almost 2 hours, it was a long time.
Okay, so after you finished your workout and after you played basketball, is when you finally called your wife?
While I was playing basketball, while I was outside.
And I actually made the assumption.
Obviously, I wasn't on my phone playing basketball, I was calling my wife at the same time. But as I walked outside, got the basketball, shot a couple of times, stopped, called my wife, kept on playing basketball after.
Did you attempt to speak with the battalion chief?
No, I did not.
Or anyone else in the line of authority?
No, I did not.
Was this kind of a dilemma or any kind of ethical dilemmas covered when you were in training?
Objection, relevance.
She hasn't come across, so I'm going to go out. Have you received any training on ethical dilemmas?
Certainly, I'm sure we probably have.
Well, do you happen to recall what your training dictated you should do in that situation?
No, I did not remember.
And how many times did you speak with Mr. Kennerly about your misgivings?
As I stated before, it was that I believe it was just only the one time the shift happened. That shift after that.
When you say the shift after that, would that have been the same day or the next day?
That's 3 days later, or 2 days later. We work every third day, so.
Okay.
And then I figured there was money to talk about for me.
Okay. If I could ask you to take a look again at the workers' compensation form, page 3, the witness statement. Please tell us what time you say in the report as when Mr. Cranford or Lieutenant Cranford was injured.
$1,600.
That would be 4 p.m.?
Correct.
So he was actually claiming a future injury when he came in for water?
Sure.
Did you happen to note that when you reviewed the report? That, I guess, best case scenario, he would have actually been standing in the kitchen when this injury supposedly happened, according to the report and your recollection of time?
As far as when I was reading this report, I already knew what it was about because I heard the conversation, had some of the conversation with him and Firefighter Carolyn, and I was really upset. So when I was reading it, I didn't really even pay attention to what I was reading.
Hey, take a look at this, read over it. What did you take that to mean?
I mean to read it.
And do what?
He asked me if I had any questions on it. I said no. And that was the last I've seen this paper before we ever talked about it.
Okay. A Is today the first time that you've seen this particular piece of paper since then?
I actually seen it 2 days ago when my lawyer showed it to me.
Then if you were pretty upset and you thought you already knew what was contained in the report on that day, but again, you didn't really read through it. And you didn't see the report again until 2 days ago. How was it that you knew that Lieutenant Cranford had lied in this report?
Never said I didn't read through it. I read through it. But you know, when you're a little bit upset, you might not know exactly what was said. Like, I couldn't repeat this verbatim.
So at the time that this took place, you had 3 months remaining on probationary status, right?
Yeah, 3 months.
And it wasn't until 5 months after the incident that you said anything to anyone about your misgivings?
No.
Okay, so during the 2 months when you'd actually gotten through probationary status, you didn't have to worry about just being summarily terminated from your position, why didn't you do anything then?
Objection, relevance. I've also been asked an answer about why he hasn't done these things.
Overrule, all out.
Why didn't I do anything about it? It was passed.
Did you approach Ms. Lindstrom or did she approach you?
As I stated earlier, I came back from the hospital for therapy for my elbow. And Lieutenant Lindstrom was there with Chief Chapman, and that's the first I've heard. That's the last time I've heard about it.
May I ask what happened to your elbow?
Fell off the ladder, pressure fire.
When did you fall off the ladder?
June 28th or 29th.
Did you fill out a worker's? Did you fill out a worker's compensation form?
Objection to relevance.
How is that relevant?
Well, I think it goes to practice and procedure within the fire department. If this isn't something that was always followed,
I'll allow it as to the WC1 if you fill one out or one was filled out to his knowledge for him, but the particulars of his injury or what happened subsequent are not relevant. We're not going to go down that road.
I'm trying to find out about signatures.
Okay.
I did not fill one out for me. Obviously, I was in the hospital, but I'm almost positive Captain McCorder did, and I signed it. And then I was out of work for 7 weeks, so I don't think I 100%.
Okay, and it was Captain
David McCorder.
Okay, and what was his relationship to you employment-wise?
He is a safety officer. But he was the one that picked me up from the incident and brought me to the hospital.
And do you know whether or not the battalion chief ever signed off?
No.
Okay, thank you.
Redirect.
Corrigan, when Mr. Cranford showed you page 3 of that document, could you describe the manner in which he presented it to you? Was it a casual conversation or was it more authoritative?
He just asked me to read it. It wasn't either or. It was just, you know, can you read this?
Did you feel you had no choice but to go along with the situation?
I mean, given, you know, the probationary and just him being my boss, I felt like I had to go along with the whole situation, the whole scenario.
And I just want to be clear, based on some of the questions that you had, that you got across. Have you ever had ladder training at Fire Station 4 prior to April, to this date of the incident?
No, not that I can recall.
Prior to and including April 3rd, 2011, had you ever seen Mr. Cranford fall from a ladder?
No, I haven't.
You were asked on cross, and I don't believe you answered the question. I think they kind of compounded it. Whether Mr. Cranford was a stickler for the rules. Do you think he was, in fact, a stickler for the rules?
I think he was straightforward with what he wanted and what he wanted done. and how we want it done, which I would expect from any lieutenant or any boss.
Was there times where he seemed to bend the rules that you're aware of?
No.
Okay. I have nothing further then.
Recross.
I have two questions for you. Do you recall doing a morning check off that day?
Objection, scope.
Sustained.
Did you ever attempt to speak with Lieutenant Cranford directly about your concerns?
No, I haven't.
Thank you.
Questions from the board?
I have nothing at this time.
Mr. Smith?
When you talked with your wife, what did you tell her? And what did she say?
I told her what happened and what was going on with the whole statement and the scenario. And she agreed that, you know, I should just be quiet and let it be.
Did Firefighter Kennerly tell you that he had spoken with Ms. Lindstrom?
No, he did not.
You didn't know that because you were in the hospital. Were you at the hospital at the time? You spoke with her 5 months from April, would have been September, October. He never told you that he had spoken.
No, I didn't. I didn't know until way further down the process that he spoke with her first.
Were you disciplined for not reporting this at the time that it happened?
No, I was not.
You testified that you still respected Mr. Cranford after this event?
Yes.
How could you respect him?
I feel, as far as a firefighter, he's a really good firefighter, and he made a bad decision.
You do know you felt bad because you were being involved. If in fact, he did what?
I felt bad for two reasons. That one, the second one is, I felt like I should have stepped up and said, and protected him a little more, saying when this came about, said, no, you know, we shouldn't do that. I should have got more involved and maybe ask more questions or whatever I need to be.
It might have saved his job. You're aware of that.
Correct.
Does that bother you?
Correct. Yes, it does.
I have nothing else.
Dr. Kyle, any questions?
I don't.
Firefighter Corrigan, you are going to be released to return to your normal duties at this time. The rules of sequestration have been invoked, which means that I'm instructing you not to discuss your testimony here with anyone until the hearing is complete. Are recalled in this case, between now and then you can talk to Mr. Mondelli or Ms. Jones, but no one else. You'll be notified through your chain of command when the hearing is complete. At that point, talk to whoever you want to about what your testimony was or questions that were asked, but I'm instructing you, not even your wife, but I want you to talk about your testimony today to anyone until the hearing is complete. You understand that instruction?
Yes, sir.
With that, you're released to return to your normal duties. Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Who's your next witness?
Next would be Lieutenant Lindstrom.
Okay. Okay, if you'd raise your right hand, please. You solemnly swear the evidence you're about to give to this board is the whole truth. You solemnly swear the evidence you're about to give in the matter now pending before this board is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. So, God.
Yes, sir.
Very much. State your name for the record.
Debbie Lindstrom.
And your position with Forsyth County?
I am a fire investigator and internal affairs officer.
Thank you very much. You may examine.
Thank you. Lieutenant Lindstrom, good morning.
Good morning.
Can you please state first how long you've worked with Forsyth County Fire Department?
I've been with Forsyth County Fire Department full time since April of 2002.
And in your current position, are you responsible for internal investigations?
When they're assigned to me, yes.
Okay. And when you conduct internal investigations, are you following particular policies or procedures and how you carry them out?
Yes, I have to be instructed to do the investigation. If it comes to me first, I take it to the chain, through the chain of command to Chief Owen.
Let's ask this question. How did you first become aware of incident involving Jeremy Cranford that we're here for today?
I was in a leadership class at the Roswell Ferretta Training Center, and it was the end of August. And Firefighter Kennerly was seated behind me. I don't really know him that well. They were talking about ethics, morals, really hammering in supervisor liability. And he mentioned to me at break that he was upset and concerned about something that had happened and in the past, and he didn't know what to do about it. And I said, well, you know, that's up to you, you know. So the next day, we didn't really talk. The next day, he mentioned the workers' comp claim and that he was upset about it and just couldn't, for lack of, you know, quoting him, he just didn't want to deal with that internally anymore. He thought that someone needed to know about it.
After Mr. Kennerly told you about this incident on that day, what did you do?
I listened to briefly what he had to say and finished the class. And I think the next week I spoke with my boss, who is Chief Wallace, who's the head of our division, told him briefly what had gone on. I made an inquiry with Ms. Green, I think, if there was actually a workers' comp claim. She said yes. I didn't really tell her anything. And then, so I went with my boss to Chief Bowman, told him the situation. He instructed me to go see Ms. Pat Carson. I made an appointment with Ms. Carson. I went up to see her and discussed the matter with her. She ordered a internal investigation be done. And that's how investigation came about.
So as part of your investigation, what was the first step in that investigation?
The first step in the investigation was to identify the workers' comp claim. As Lieutenant Cranford was their direct supervisor, she told me that she would like to place him on administrative paid leave.
And you say she?
Ms. Carson.
Okay.
Because it would create an uncomfortable environment. And I told her, I think, you know, that it wouldn't take very long, you know, to look into something like this.
I'm going to show you what has been marked as Forsyth County 3. Lieutenant, do you recognize that document?
Yes.
What is it?
It is the notice of administrative leave notification where Jeremy Cranford was placed on paid leave.
And is your signature on that document?
Yes, it is.
And what is the date of the document?
September 6, 2011.
And is this a true and accurate copy of the administrative leave form that you presented and signed off on?
Yes,
at that time. This time I move to admit Forsyth County 3 into evidence.
Any objection?
No objection.
FC3 is submitted without objection. You may publish it.
I am publishing. Lieutenant, when you presented this form to Lieutenant Cranford, what was his response?
I met with his battalion chief. I have to go through his chain of command, met with his battalion chief, and we went to Station 4 to meet with Lieutenant Cranford, and I told him that he was going to be placed on paid leave pending an internal investigation, and personnel services would be in touch with him.
Did you inform him as to the specifics of the investigation at that time?
No.
After placing Lieutenant Cranford on the leave, what did you do subsequently?
Got his key card and his fuel key, and he took his personal items. He was afforded the opportunity to look through his computer at work. I just sat while he went through everything he wanted to go through, any station files. I think he looked through some station files and got what items that he wanted to remove from the station at that time.
And then in your investigation, what were your next steps?
My next steps were to investigate the form itself. I met with Ms. Clark and asked her for a copy of the form.
Is that form what's been admitted as Forsyth County 1?
Yes.
Okay. And when you investigated with Ms. Clark as to the form, what did you determine?
I determined that he had in fact filled out this form, and there were no witness statements. I verified that with her, because normally if you have a witness to an incident, then we asked them to write a witness statement corroborating what had happened.
And was there any other problems that you had with the workers' compensation form?
What I noticed myself was, aside from the witness statements, were that a safety officer was not called, there was no supervisor signature, nor a battalion chief's. There were no supervisory signatures on this form.
Subsequent to reviewing this form, did you pull any other documentation related to this incident?
This was the first thing I did. I did pull the training record off the firehouse and took pictures of that. I took pictures of the station log where they describe sometimes what they do during the day to photograph that, yes.
And these are pictures of a computer screenshot?
Yes.
I'm going to first show you what's been marked previously as Forsyth County 2. Do you recognize this photograph?
Yes.
What is it?
It is a training log off of Firehouse, our software, where the firefighters enter their training hours.
This is a photograph that you personally took?
Yes.
And is this a true and accurate copy of the photograph that you took?
Yes.
At this time, I move to admit Forsyth County 2 into evidence.
Any objection?
No.
I'll move to publish.
FC2 is admitted without objection.
Lieutenant Lindstrom, when you examined this computer file, what did you note about it that was relevant to this case?
Well, there was no way to tell exactly who the author was of who put the training in. In interviews, I learned that Firefighter Corrigan and Kennerly say they did not put this training in, and also there should be a 8.5 by 11 hard copy training sheet that each person's supposed to sign, verifying that they in fact did the training, which comes up here to headquarters, and the training officers file that in their training files.
Okay. Now, with regards to the computer entries, is there also a summary section?
Yes.
That also can be filled in?
Yes.
Did you examine any summary sections related to the computer entry?
I believe there is a summary section that details the training that took place.
I'm going to show you what has been marked as Forsyth County 4. And I apologize. Just closing counsel with another copy of the black and white, but it's all still legible. Lieutenant Lindstrom, do you recognize Forsyth County 4?
Yes, I took a picture of this screenshot.
And what is it?
It is the summary of the training that took place and that Lieutenant Cranford fell to the ground on the asphalt landing on his left arm and left side of the body.
And what is the date of the incident that he says this took place on?
April 3rd, 2011.
Is this a true and accurate copy of the photograph you took?
Yes.
This time I move to admit Forsyth County 4 into evidence.
No objection.
Without objection.
Move to publish. Lieutenant Lindstrom, you also mentioned that there were hard copy documentation that should have been completed. Can you just restate for me what that was?
It is a 8.5 by 11 sheet of paper with training information. I believe it's going to ask for the name, rank, who was there, what they did, and each person, there's a line for each person who participated in the training to sign.
I'm going to show you copy of what I'm marking as Forsyth County 5. Lindstrom, do you recognize this document?
Yes, this is the Fire Department training report.
And is this the document that you were just describing?
Yes.
Is this a true and accurate copy of the form that's supposed to be filled out during training exercises?
Yes.
This time I move to admit Forsyth County 5 into evidence.
Before there is an objection, is there a date on the document?
There is no date on this document.
These are on our main, Estron, so the firefighters go on there, they print them out, say if they were gonna do ladder training that day, he would fill this out, each person would be listed here, and they would sign here that they, in fact, did this training, and that's kept up here for audits, I guess, by the state.
So this is just an example of the form?
Yes, this
it's
is
not tied towards any particular training?
No, this is what I could not find.
I'm just trying to inquire.
It's an example of the form that would have been used in that situation.
It would have been dated if you found one?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Should have been.
I'm sorry I interrupted you, Ms. Jones. Do you have any objection to this?
I think it can come in for descriptive purposes, but it's not actually evidence of any
I concur. I'm going to admit it for demonstrative purposes only. It is not proof of any fact one way or the other, board, only that this is a form that is used in the department.
May I publish comments?
You may publish.
Thank you.
With that instruction to the board that it's for demonstrative purposes only, pursuant to Ms. Jones' objection.
Lieutenant, did you find a copy of a Forsyth County Fire Department training report that ties in with the incident that Mr. Cranford has alleged took place?
No, I looked in Station 4's files. I looked in all three shift files. I also met with Captain Wilson in the training division and asked him if he had received the completed form, and he does not have that form either. I also, under direction of Ms. Carson, checked Lieutenant Cranford's individual drive on his computer, thinking maybe it was scanned in and on his drive, and it was not located there either.
To be clear, going back to exhibits 2 and 4, the two photographs, to your knowledge, are those entries that needed to have either Firefighter Kennerly or Firefighter Corrigan sign off of them in order to be entered or created in this Forsyth County database?
No. Their lieutenant or whoever he designates can enter everybody's training in the system. At that time, they could.
But with regard to the training report, is there any way for, let me rephrase, the training report requires the actual signature of any witnesses. Is that accurate?
It requires the signature of the participants.
And to be clear, you did not find any document completed for April 3rd, 2011 related to this workers' comp claim?
Yes, sir.
Did you find any other logs or notations made by Mr. Cranford regarding this training?
In the fire station log, they have a book where they log when they come on duty, what they do that day. Some of them, I think, list their calls. And I photographed Station 4's log for that day, for April 3rd.
I'm going to show you what's been marked as Forsyth County 6. Lieutenant Lindstrom, do you recognize Forsyth County 6?
Yes.
What is it?
This is a photograph of the page in their log sheet on their duty day of April 3rd, 2011.
And is this a photograph that you yourself took?
I took this photograph.
Is this a true and accurate copy of the logbook page for April 3rd, 2011 as when you took it that day?
Yes.
And this time I move to admit Forsyth County 6 into evidence.
Any objection?
No objection.
Submitted without objection. Be public.
Lieutenant, who is responsible for maintaining the logbook?
It's been a while since I've been in the field, but generally the lieutenant will be the one who is responsible for the log. If he's not there or assigned someone else, I believe that they would do that under his instruction.
To your knowledge, do you know who filled out the logbook on for April 3rd, 2011?
I did not.
The logbook indicates that training did take place?
It says yes, it does.
Subsequent to reviewing these documents, did you conduct any interviews related to this matter?
I did. I interviewed Firefighter Corrigan, Kennerly, and Mr. Cranford.
And after conducting those interviews, did you draw any conclusions about the incident?
I'm sorry, I also interviewed the battalion chief.
Okay.
I did. My job is not to... My job is just as a fact finder to sustain or not sustain. And I, based on the evidence and the interviews that I had, I felt that this training did not take place.
And why is that?
There's no supporting evidence that the training took place except for on the computer, which is easily done. There's no supporting signatures. The two firefighters have never been written up by Mr. Cranford, and to my knowledge, they had no reason to make up a lie to try to get him in trouble or him lose his job. Based on their distress and demeanor, in my experience as an investigator, I felt that these two gentlemen were telling me the truth when I interviewed them.
Did you prepare a report of your official findings?
I did.
What did you do with that report?
When my report was completed, I gave it to Chief Bowman and to Ms. Pat Parson.
I'm going to show you what's been marked as fourth at county number 7.
May I add, in addition to my interviews, the lack of supporting witness statements were a high probability that this did not occur because they said they would not write a statement and they wouldn't sign a training report because it did not happen.
Might I ask a question just for clarification? On FC6, on the work log,
yes,
where does it show that they did the training?
It says under training complete, they have EMS training, 8 hours, station 4, and then under that it says ground ladders, 2 hours, station 4.
Okay.
It doesn't say a time or anything. It just states ground ladders.
Well, I just wondered because they didn't have a time by
yes,
that,
sir.
And so I'm sorry. Thank you.
Lieutenant, regarding Forsyth County 7, do you recognize the document?
I do.
And what is it?
This is the findings based on the investigation of this incident.
And is this a true and accurate, did you prepare this report?
Yes.
Is it a true and accurate copy of the report that you prepared?
Yes.
At this time, I move to admit Forsyth County 7 into evidence.
Any objection?
No objection.
Submitted without objection.
Move to publish. Lieutenant, what were your findings with regards to violations?
Sustained.
And what specific violations did you find?
Willfully, I met with Ms. Carson on the findings on the violations and false statements to supervisors, officials, or the public. Falsification of documents. And violations of the ethics code.
Now, are these violations laid out in written policy?
Yes.
I'm going to show you two documents, Forsyth County 8, Forsyth County 9. Lieutenant Lindstrom, do you recognize these documents?
I do.
What are they?
These are the documents that are in our, I believe, civil service handbook, as well as our employee handbook and our SOGs.
Okay. And to your knowledge, are these true and accurate copies of the...
One moment. Go ahead.
Are these true and accurate copies of the policies and procedures that you just described?
Yes.
At this time, I would move to admit Forsyth County 8 and 9.
I think it's the same document that was a private.
I don't. One is policy of disciplinary actions. The other is Forsyth County Fire Department standards of conduct. If I gave you two of the same, I apologize.
I have two standards of conduct.
Okay, pardon me. Trade you again.
So which one's the standards of conduct, 8 or 9?
9 is standards of conduct, 8 is disciplinary actions.
And the disciplinary action is from the civil service policy?
That's correct.
I'll give you just a minute, Ms. Jones, tell me when you're ready.
Signatures.
Oh, pardon me. We can clarify that. You know, there's some circles and initials on the documents. Do you know who those belong to?
Chief Bowman. No objection.
FC8 and FC9 are admitted without objection. I ask you to stop for about 20 seconds while our clerk changes the batteries on the recording.
May I publish during that time?
You can publish during that time.
Lieutenant Lindstrom, turning first to the policy 8 disciplinary actions. You indicate that, in your opinion, Lieutenant Cranford violated policy 8, section 2F, willfully giving false statements to supervisors, officials, and the public. Can you please articulate why, how you drew that conclusion?
Because he falsely stated that he had an injury, told his battalion chief he had an injury. Therefore,
and did the workers' comp claim also constitute a false statement?
Yes.
With regard to Handbook Policy 8, Section 2L, falsification or destruction of official records or documents or use of official position for personal benefit, profit, or advantage, you sustain that. Can you articulate how Mr. Cranford violated Section 2L?
The falsification of the workers' comp record, the training records as well.
With regard to Policy 8, Section 2Z, violation of any provisions of the Forsyth County Ethics Code, Employee Handbook, or the applicable departmental SOP. And then you indicate Forsyth County Fire Department SOGs Article 6 and Article 31. Can you explain how he made those violations? And I believe that also then relates to the standards of conduct that's also been admitted in evidence.
As far as the ethics code, that would be lying. As far as Article 6 on the standards of conduct, you're to report immediately your illness or sickness to your supervisor or injury and not falsify that report.
And with regard to Article 31?
False and inaccurate statements or reports.
And just to be clear, can you explain how you believe Cranford violated that?
You are accountable for the reports you submit and that they will be accurate and complete. Lieutenant Cranford didn't follow our general practice and have a supervisor sign it. There were no witness statements and there was no safety officer notified on this incident.
I'd like to now turn your attention to Forsyth County 1, once again, the workers' comp form. I would refer you to the very bottom of the first page, the fine print. And I would ask you to read that out loud into the record.
If you have any questions, please contact the State Board of Workers' Compensation at, can't really read the number. There's also an 800 number, or visit their website.
Willfully, the line below it?
Yes. Willfully making false statements for the purpose of obtaining or denying benefits is a crime subject to the penalties of up to $10,000 per violation. And there's an OCGA code, which I cannot make out right here.
Did you include that OCGA code in your report?
I did.
In your opinion, did Mr. Cranford's conduct also rise to the level of a criminal violation?
It is a crime in the state of Georgia to falsify a workers' comp claim form.
And did you notify county officials of this fact?
I notified. Risk management's aware of it, and ACCG, I guess, would make that determination of what they would want to do depending on the outcome of this.
I have nothing further at this time, subject to cross-examination.
Ms. Jones, how long do you anticipate the cross of the 10 minutes will be?
20 to 25 minutes.
I'm not going to interrupt it. We're going to adjourn for lunch, and because I don't want to get halfway through it. And,
I appreciate that.
Well, I try to understand where the lawyers come from. Mr. Smith, do you think we can be back by 1 o'clock, 1:15, what time?
I would think so. We can be back whenever you want to be. I'm riding with you.
That's right. let's resume this hearing at 1 p.m. We'll be in recess until that time. Thank you very much.
May I inquire how many more witnesses they're anticipating?
Upon conclusion of Lieutenant Lindstrom's testimony, I would say no more than two.
Okay. Thank you.
We'll be in recess until 1 o'clock.
Maybe this is an unusual question. Are they locked in the room?
I don't know if it's locked, but I can assure you that your materials and equipment will be safe here.
I love them.
Thank you.
Yes, you may.
I appreciate it.